Okay, good morning, everyone. Thank you for your patience. We've got everybody in the house now, so we're going to go ahead and get started. My name is Chris Johnson. I'm the Freeman Chair in China Studies here at CSIS. I want to thank you for coming to this very interesting report launch by Dan Rosen and Beibei Bao with regard to a sort of more accurate look at China's economy. When Dan first approached me about this subject and working with him jointly along with Matt Goodman and our Simon Chair in Political Economy, as a sort of non-economist, initially my eyes glaze over when when he explained to me what we were doing. But then listening to him in greater depth, I really was impressed by not only, of course, the deep statistical and other talent that has been put into this report, but also its approachability for those of us who are not deep economic experts. And I think both Dan and Beibei have done an outstanding job, primarily in the recent sort of summary report that we released last week that kind of highlights their findings, and they're looking at ways to pitch this appropriately for various audiences. I think it's also fair to say that, you know, there's no better time than now to be looking at something like this, given all of the recent issues that we've seen in China and real concerns developing about how much of a grip, if you will, the managers of Chinese economy have on that development, and gauging the size of China's economy more accurately certainly could not be more important at this stage. So I want to thank Dan and Beibei for their excellent work and for their willingness to partner with us here at CSIS on this. I know I speak for Matt Goodman as well in that, and I'm going to turn it over to them for a presentation, and that will be followed by a panel moderated by my colleague Scott Kennedy and some experts that we've got along for the ride. So Dan. You going to go ahead and jump in? Yep. Okay, great.
Thank you, Chris. And good morning, everybody. And I should start by just saying this collaboration between CSIS and the Rhodium Group predates my arrival. And usually when someone says that, it means they want to absolve themselves of responsibility and the negative consequences that follow. But actually, that's decidedly not the case here. I lucked into this relationship and this study, and we're all the beneficiaries of Dan Bay's tremendous work. This study and the paper that was issued yesterday is both part of the Simon Chair and the Freeman Chair, and fits into the project on Chinese business and political economy that we started this year, which presents a 360-degree look at the economic policy process, trends in industrial policy, and China's growing role in global economic governance. And as we do that, we'll have a new occasional paper series, and the paper that we just issued yesterday by Dan and Bay that summarizes their key points of today's study, which you're going to hear about, it artfully titled Improving the Abacus. Their report asks one of the most fundamental questions about China that undergirds many of the discussions we have in Washington about the country, but that we never try to answer because it's too hard for us to answer, but not too hard for them. They're going to tell you their answer in a few minutes, but I just want to say one thing about the answer that's in this report. Washington likes to think of China in sharp terms. Monster powerhouse or economy on the brink of collapse, enemy or partner, panda huggers, dragon slayers, fundamental reformers or returning to central planning. And this study does something that's quite different than that. It defies pigeonholing, one-sidedness, simplistic conclusions in favor of something else. The truth. The complicated, messier reality. So as you listen, don't try to force Dan and Bay into one box or another, because they just don't fit. And you got to ask, well, why don't they fit? And that's because they're not from Washington. They're from the real world. They're from New York City. Dan's a founding partner of the Rhodium Group, and if you don't know, rhodium is atomic number 45 on the periodic table. He's also a senior associate here in the Simon Chair. He's been an adjunct professor at Columbia for many years, and he previously served on the National Economic Council and National Security Council, and he's the author of numerous studies on China's economy and its foreign investment regime and Chinese investment abroad. Beibei Bao is a research analyst at the Rhodium Group, where she monitors and analyzes business, regulatory, and political developments in China. Her work has appeared in publications by CSIS, Harvard University, the Aspen Institute Italia, and elsewhere. She holds two BAs from Beida and two masters from Columbia. They're going to make about a 15 to 20 minute presentation of the report's key findings, and then we will invite our three commentators to come up to the stage to offer their thoughts on the study, and then we'll open up things to the floor for questions. This event is on the record, but everyone, including me, are speaking in their personal capacities and not representing any organization. So with that, please join me in turning things over to Dan and Beibei. We're so glad you're here. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Scott and Chris, for those introductions. It's terrific to be here. We have a huge amount of material we want to try to cover with you this morning in the time we have, so I'm going to move pretty quickly to do that. We have some amazing panelists. They need to be part of the conversation about this study. We need to get to that as quickly as possible, too. So we're going to move fast through our initial presentation of what we've done here. Chris mentioned at the outset that there's no better time to put a study on the table trying to grapple with the nominal size of China's GDP, its gross domestic product, the size of its economy, rather than just the growth rate, which we often revert to dealing with that because it's a little easier to grapple with. It may probably true that there's no better time. There's also no better place, because CSIS provides us with a somewhat more skeptical audience of not just economists, but people from all the different cones of policy interest, not just American perspectives, but perspectives from around the world. And it is the perfect test bed for us to see whether we've achieved our objective, which is to make one of the most arcane topics known to man, national income accounting, accessible to all the folks who should have an ability to understand it and be able to make sense of it, because as we're about to argue, it very much does affect your own interests, both from the national perspective and ultimately from the individual perspective as well. So the era of obscurity in terms of the truer measure of China's economic size should now be over, and we should be turning the page to a new era now. As I said, there has been a lot of work on China's GDP growth, and much, much less work, although some very good work, on China's nominal economic size. How big is that thing actually, regardless of how much it grows each year? There are a number of reasons why this is so much more important a question today than it was just a few years ago. The first is, of course, the pace at which China's economy is growing and evolving. There's a bunch of pairs of bars on the slide behind me, that the first of which in each couplet described China in 2000, the second in China in 2013. You see in all these key economic variables like GDP size, the second pair of bars, we're talking about a tripling of China's weight in global economic activity in a little bit more than a decade. That's true of China in terms of exports and imports of goods and services as well, in terms of inward investment, and very much so more than a 70-fold increase in China as an outbound global direct investor. Get down to the end of the chart and you see the flows of portfolio capital that haven't even really begun. And we're going to see that kind of tripling, quadrupling, and more in the years just ahead. So very fast. And an economy growing that fast is bound to have some disruptive consequences for its partners out there around the world. And hence, we really do have
partners out there around the world.
Interest in and hence, we really do have a sound understanding of China's keen interest GDP in size. Having a, secondly, whereas once China was big enough to matter, today it's gargantuan in global terms, second largest economy in the world, only the second in the 14-digit club, if you will, passing $10 trillion in GDP, along with the United States. So the absolute size of this economy now is so big that everybody has an interest in being comfortable with their understanding of the size of China's GDP. Thirdly, despite the pace that we've become accustomed to and the absolute size China's reached, it is slowing. And that is acknowledged universally. Nobody questions that we have a significant slowdown in the pace of China's GDP growth. So we know that's taking place. And to figure out just what that might mean to us, we have to have confidence in what the underlying size of the thing that's slowing is. It matters to us immensely, because today we look at China's annual contribution to marginal global growth, the bars in green here, relative to all global growth taking place. And even though China's kind of hanging in there at a steady state of, say, $1 trillion of additional global demand activity a year, overall world growth is slower now than it was during the recovery from the financial crisis a few years ago, making China's share and the sustainability of it that much more important. Which brings us to the starts to get kind of wonky, nitty-gritty, granular stuff that you're going to have to bear with as we dig through and Beibei digs through in the minutes to follow. China has only since 1993 officially used gross domestic product as their standard measure for their own economy. Prior to that, it was the Soviet-era material production system, an alternative way of trying to measure things, which reminds us that when things really came out in the laundry, we realized that the Soviet economy was only maybe half as large as we thought it was during our period of greatest geoeconomic concern about their performance versus ours, which forces us to ask the question, you know, how comfortable can we be with the stated size of the Chinese economy? In a series of revisions to their nominal GDP over past decades, China has acknowledged the need to significantly revise what they had previously stated their economy to be in terms of size. You see the first national census in 2004 and the second in 2008. The first led to an upward revision of China's GDP size of almost 17%. Very significant, but China was a developing country at that point. Nobody doubted that, and we knew that a big recount of the services sector had to come, had to be made. In 2008, 4.4% upward revision, again, in large part due to service sector activity that hadn't been previously captured. Which brings us to 2013 census. As China was getting started with its next five-year census on the year 2013, we started our work here in partnership with CSIS to, in parallel, do the same exercise, do our recount of what previous numbers had been to see how accurate we thought they were. When results came out last December, Beijing reported an upward revision to GDP of 3.4%. In the slides that follow and in the 244-page study available on the website as of this morning, we provide as authoritative an answer as is probably possible at this point in time. Our panelists will either validate that or invalidate that assertion as to whether we think that 3.4% is a reasonable re-estimation of what the true size of China's economy is. Before I hand it over to Bei in about 30 seconds, let me just point out one methodological compromise we had to make in order to be able to do this. To do this kind of a basic assessment of nominal GDP, you need data. And you need data on the value added of Chinese output. That data has not been made available out of Beijing since 2008, for reasons that we may get into a discussion of. So we had to go back and use 2008 as our base year for recalculating, re-estimating what we thought GDP actually was. And then bring those results forward and make an extrapolation about whether we think they're valid for describing what GDP adjustments are required for the present period, which we do in the end of the study. In the course of going back and doing that, thinking about how reliable Chinese GDP practices are in order to use that kind of a methodology, we actually got very impressed and very comfortable with the hard, slogging work that China's National Bureau of Statistics has done over the past 2.5 decades in particular. These guys are well-educated, they're sophisticated, they're earnest. They're working just about as hard as anybody possibly could among statistical authorities to try to provide their leadership with a more accurate gauge of what's happening in the Chinese economy. That put us in a position to use a lot of what they're doing to try to build the study. And Bei's going to pick it up from there and tell you a little bit about how we did it and where we came out.
Thanks, Dan. It's really a truly privilege to share our findings from this two-year study with you today. And it's a gratitude to Chris and Scott for having us here. Rarely is the volatility of China's economy felt as strong and the accuracy of China's data thought as critical as present, as Dan just mentioned. There's actually a lot of pressure speaking after him, because when I prepared this presentation, I thought to myself, as soon as I start to speak, people will realize I'm not nearly as eloquent a speaker as him. But just as a Chinese old saying goes, that people who are barefoot should more or less than those wearing shoes. So I'm barefoot today. Bear with me for the next 12 minutes or so as we walk through some of the main findings and also the key points of our methodology. A major part of my job at Rhodium is to quant Chinese data. Oftentimes, we encounter problems such as that data do not really comport with each other, or data series that are discontinued for unknown reasons. A common solution for number quanters is to come up with their own proxies to guesstimate the real conditions. In China's case, this sometimes work and sometimes does not. Just look at this chart, China's quarterly GDP growth benchmarked against the popular Li Keqiang Index. For those who are not already familiar with index, this is a growth proxy combining bank loans, real freight, and power consumption that's said to be used by Premier Li when he was the head of Liaoning Province in 2007. Later, this index was used more extensively by economists to gauge the national economy. But we all know that Liaoning is a heavy industry province that is not quite representative of other parts of China, such as Guangdong. So for this and several other reasons, this proxy today has been increasingly discredited by China watchers, and it has never been officially endorsed by Beijing. In fact, in many, if not most cases, when someone on the outside publicly challenged Chinese data, Beijing would usually remain silent or respond pretty passively, like, this is not how we do things, but to stop short of saying how exactly they do things. Oh, of course, there are institutional reasons behind it, as well as cultural reasons. So for this study, Dan and I wanted to do a pretty bold experiment by doing the numbers from inside the system. We looked closely at how Beijing crunched GDP numbers and found the official method there was not quite unreplicable. We decided to recreate the process by following the official methods wherever possible, to the point that we can't, and we would then employ some alternative approaches to get to the high line. So the underlying methodology for our study here is to follow the official methodology so that our results can be compared with the official numbers. An important change we adopted for this exercise was to count some certain economic output in new ways defined in the latest international standard of GDP accounting, the System of National Accounts 2008. This was a necessary treatment to make the foundations of GDP of China and that of advanced economies such as US and EU member states comparable. How so? Because simply put, there are currently two types of GDP accounting standards internationally in use, a 1993 version and an updated 2008 version. Advanced economies such as the US, EU member states, New Zealand, Australia, they have made the transition over the last 6 years or so, and Beijing has not. So by including some of the latest changes in 2008 version, our study has to some extent narrowed the methodological gap there. I will provide two examples later. Here's a quick look at our the menus and guidelines we use, as well as the resources. Two official Chinese GDP menus as guidelines, as described. These are where Beijing documents their principles and critical calculation steps. And also the Chinese System of National Accounts 2002, which is based on the 1993 version of the UN standard. And also the latest 2008 SNA. And also the enterprise level databases, which we source the raw enterprise level data to conduct bottom-up calculations and a number of official, quasi-official, real economy metrics and historical data to facilitate the calculations. Here we move on to the results. The re-estimates of China's secondary sector. We're going to go with the secondary sector and then move on to tertiary, primary, and also the R&D. China's industry and construction combined, they are called the secondary sector of China. It should be pointed out that, like in many advanced economies such as the US, the primary approach of counting GDP in China is not by expenditure, but by sector. So expenditure GDP, based GDP focused on final uses such as household consumption and investment, but sector-based GDP looks at the value creation in production activities such as wholesale, retail, accommodation, catering services, manufacturing, farming, so on and so forth. So following the official method, then I look at sector activities as well. In China, secondary sector, which includes mining, manufacturing, utility, and construction, we found undercounted values. It's mainly a result of incomplete data collection from small services. China has not introduced a comprehensive internet-based data collection system until 2012. And prior to that, the data reporting system was pretty fragmented and heavily relied on hard copy documents, which has made national accounting work very challenging. And not only we have advised up the output from small services, we have also used the tax and other supplementary data to adjust down the output from the large enterprises. Over-reporting, especially those driven by political reasons, was a serious concern in China's data system, and we have addressed that straightforwardly in the study. And this is only one of many examples where we look into the context of China's raw data and made adjustments as necessary when needed so that we'll feel comfortable to use the data as the raw data as the basis of our study here. And our final net results here come up to an industry 8.5% larger than the official number suggested in 2008, and the construction was 7.3%. Next slide is our results of the services sector, also known as the tertiary sector in China. Services data in China are known to be inadequate. That is partly because China's data system has historically focused on physical production instead of intangible services. So what resulted from that is when we try to use the accessible public data to add up to the headline result, sometimes the number only add up to like 50% of the official result, which means very inadequate. So for all the values of different subsectors here, which is also in the commentary at your hand, is that we have probably employed on average of four different approaches of getting to these numbers, but even in two subsectors where China's self-employed businesses, Getihu, are most concentrated, even those alternative approaches relying on Chinese data are inadequate because these numbers just do not add up. So instead, we look at eight comparable economies' numbers to using the similar economic patterns and models to deduce China's results. And here's the result of the net result of the tertiary sectors. Here is combined, we believe services were 22.2% larger than the official number suggested in 2008. It is not hard to notice in this table that real estate contributed the most change. In fact, our upward adjustment for real estate accounted for somewhere between 40 to 50% of our total revision. Why is that? Is what we come to next. In real estate, there is a sector called rental activities. Basically, it means if you are a tenant, you consume the rental service your landlord provides for you. And if you are a homeowner, you consume the virtual rental service you produce for yourselves. And how to gauge that virtual rental service since there's no money change hands? In countries where there is a mature, developed rental activity, the virtual services value is gauged by the market rate of your apartment or house, just assuming if you are renting it out to someone, what's the market rate you will charge. But in China, the value of the service is still gauged by the construction cost of your property. Obviously, there's a huge divide between the two approaches, especially considering China's real estate boom in the 2000s, particularly after the stimulus package. Beijing has pledged to fix a way to recount, to count the virtual service value in 2013, but they have not accomplished as of today. In this study, we offered new ways to do the tally. And after the upward revision, the share of real estate of China's economy would double to almost 10%. And that means a correction in the property market would have more repercussions throughout the economy and the society as we know them today. Dan will elaborate later in the conclusion. Section. And now we move on to the agricultural sector, the primary sector in China. We know that China has a every 5-year census, as then just introduced, after which they would revise the GDP levels quite substantially. But in China, that service, the census does not include agriculture sector. And instead, China has a separate once in a decade agricultural service sector, a census for years ending with 6. So next year will be the third census year for the agriculture. But because we wanted to introduce a comprehensive revision of the GDP level, so we included the agriculture sector in our exercise as well, and mainly relying on the volume, consumption, and output data to do the re-estimates and the adjustments. Based on the supply-demand balance sheets, we constructed for all the three major categories of agriculture, meaning factor of farming, animal husbandry, and fishery. We have found over-reporting in all of them, possibly out of the farmers and the fishermen's motive to get more subsidies from the government, which is a strong inherent incentive as we have identified. And that boils down to an agricultural GDP 3.2% smaller than the official result. And our final line of a major adjustment here is to include something that is not considered in China's current framework of GDP accounting today, capitalizing R&D expenditures, research and development expenditures. This is a major new move in the ISNA 2008, the new UN standard of GDP accounting. Prior to the 2008 standard, R&D spending was treated as intermediate input. That means something to be consumed instead of something to be invested in order to generate value in future production activities. The 2008 UN method corrected that, dictating that R&D spending, just like investment in you put into build a new plant, that should be counted as investment because that will generate value in future activities. Advanced economies such as the US and other EU member states have made the transition. Again, Beijing has not. We made a first attempt in the study to quantify the capitalization of R&D expenditures using both national survey data as well as publicly listed company intangible asset data. But because of some of the technical difficulties there, we were not able to get a specific number as we did for the previous three broad sectors. Instead, we concluded with a revision range, which means if considering the capitalization of R&D spending, China's nominal GDP in 2008 will be boosted by from 0.14% to 3.4%, depending on how much of the R&D from enterprises that has already been covered. Just to give you some comparative context, in the US case in 2012, the capitalization of R&D added 2.5% to the nominal GDP level, and the OECD average in terms of impact from the capitalization was 2.2%. These are some interesting food for thought in terms of analyzing the rapidly growing technology-driven, knowledge-driven segments of the Chinese economy. And now we have come to the final slide of my section, which is a bottom-up reconstruction of China's 2008 nominal GDP. Tertiary sector saw the sharpest change, followed by the secondary sector. And the different degrees of revision there means we will need to reassess dynamics between China's services industry in a new light. In fact, just as Dan will soon mention, that our re-estimates in the study have moved ahead the year in which China's services reached parity with industry in terms of their share of the nominal economy from 2012, as Beijing claimed, to 2009. And that will have a non-trivial impact on policy discussions in light of all the debates on restructuring, rebalancing, and the order, sequence, and the substance of the policy mandates. In other words, the end of the line of the old growth model has arrived in the middle of the Hu Jintao era instead of the Xi Jinping era. And now I'm going to pass it back to Dan to continue to talk about some of the key takeaways and implications of our findings. Thanks so much.
That was fantastic, Bei. Thank you so much. Good job. So just to finish up with about 3 minutes. Starting to distill out of this, which you've only scraped the surface of. I mean, as Bei alluded to, in most of those cases, we took every available strategy we could think of that we were aware of and we could learn about from our many advisors who helped us get our heads around this study. We did all the approaches, and we looked at the results. We saw whether they were consistent. So very often we averaged those results together or took the conservative approach to interpreting the multiple strategies for coming up with a number. I think I once gave you, Bay, a hard time about your two different approaches to estimating scallop industry value added or something like that. The scallops sector in a couple coastal provinces. It started to get that painfully granular. But the results, as Bay described, look like this, put in a more visually presentable manner, with real estate on the left side there, really the standout sector of adjustment that we think is required. If we're going to put, now, I mean, many people will react and say, well, so you're telling us that there's actually no change in the amount of stuff actually being done. It's just an accounting matter of how we count these things, right? Well, right, absolutely. When the U.S. upgraded to SNA 2008, 3 years ago, it officially, in terms of our GDP statement for ourselves, added $560 billion to our stated GDP. So make no mistake about it, nations compare themselves to one another in terms of their economic size, and that has an influence on whether we think we're doing everything right that we ought to be, and whether our peer competitors are out there as well. So the whole point of this exercise and doing the kinds of adjustments that you see presented on the slide behind me is to put China on an apples-to-apples comparable basis with its more advanced economy peer competitors, so that we can have a more accurate sense of where we stand in relation to one another to help us gauge the performance of things going forward. Talk about China being a 13 to 16% bigger economy, right? In the first cut at that, that's maybe a little bit disconcerting, and some people might find that a little alarming. But when you consider that the lion's share of the basis for that upward revision is an even greater ballooning up of China's real estate sector, properly accounted, than we thought, that's the kind of growth that doesn't just automatically add to net national power, does it? It just underscores further that an over-reliance on the real estate sector to deliver China's growth, to be the engine of China's GDP growth, is really very much a clear and present concern. Of course, for Beijing, first and foremost, but secondarily for all those nations which feed material and commodities into that real estate boom, which, if it's already at 10% of the total weight of GDP, obviously has fewer years of relatively high growth standing before it than if that sector's weight in GDP is more like 5% of overall GDP today. I said at the outset that we made the methodological compromises necessary to offer a study like this, which meant going back to 2008 as our base year, and then carrying the results forward with a discussion of whether that's a valid thing to do to the present period. This chart describes for you China's pre-2013 official upward revision of 3.4% in blue, and then green, what it means for China that it went back and upgraded its numbers in recent years in light of its most recent 2013 census, compared to our low R&D valuation and high R&D expenditure investment valuation numbers compared to that. We are quite comfortable bringing our 2008 results up to 2013 for purposes of this analysis, because virtually none of the systemic problems we identify and discuss in the text, both to do with the technical manner in which China implements its stated methodology, 1993 SNA, and none of the necessary switching up to the 2008 vintage system of national accounts, have been done and changed. So the same issues that gave rise to the need to reestimate 2008 are still completely in place in how China is doing its GDP today. You know, in other words, as we know from previous Chinese revisions in years past, they are going to come to our results. They just haven't reported it to you yet, but they will do so in the future. So what we're showing you on a slide like this is a snapshot of the future, of how China will restate the size of its own economy once they get comfortable with doing so. Let me mention seven very, very briefly, maybe a minute and a half or so here, seven key takeaways that we think are extraordinary from the study. First, of course, and foremost, China is bigger not smaller than it purports to be. And that is, you know, a pretty singular matter of debate in a lot of circles in Washington and elsewhere today. And we'll discuss that, no doubt. The service sector is the problematic part of getting national accounts right in China and getting those numbers right, just like it is for everybody else in the world. Nobody knows how to translate Craigslist into American GDP statistics in a reasonable way. Nobody knows or is comfortable with putting vulture hedge fund investors into the GDP as value added for the American economy and society, right? So the same service sector challenges China grapples with are the ones we grapple with. And too many of the GDP criticisms lobbed at Beijing are ignorant of our own very similar shortcomings and inadequacies in coming to a good count of what's going on in our economies. Thirdly, as already noted, real estate is even bigger and hence somewhat more problematic than we already know it to be, which certainly underscores the importance of thinking about policy strategies in Beijing very much today. Structural adjustment in China started even earlier than we thought, than we officially think when we have these debates about Chinese GDP. As Bei mentioned, this tertiary sector catching up to and passing industry probably happened in the middle of Hu Jintao, not the beginning of Xi Jinping. Now, it may be only the economic historians that care about when that structural adjustment process happened, but the fact that it was 4 or 5 years, or 3 or 4 years prior to what we generally think is non-trivial. A higher GDP denominator could change policy-relevant ratios. By that, all I mean for now, and maybe we'll come back to it in discussion, is that we're adjusting the denominator in this fraction, gross domestic product. We're not changing, adjusting the numerators, all the inputs that go into GDP. So debt to GDP looks a little bit better as a result of our swelling up the bottom number a little bit. Similarly, policy commitments from China that are phrased in terms of input intensities to GDP. For example, if China were to commit to change its carbon emissions as a ratio to GDP, from its 2005 level of carbon emission per unit of output, and in the process of adjusting its GDP numbers, adjusts today's GDP denominator without adjusting 2005, if you see where I'm going, it looks like more progress has been made against that starting point than is actually the case because of the way that national accounts can be adjusted from time to time and not always taken back and totally cleaned up in the old data series. That's been pointed out to our friends in Beijing, just to make sure nobody inadvertently tries to declare success on addressing carbon emissions in China. So we're on that one, but I'm sure there's dozens more ratios embedded in how we talk to our friends about their economic performance that will need to be mindful of these kinds of GDP adjustments. China could be the world's largest economy, if you're into that kind of comparison, which some people no doubt will be, a little sooner than we thought. Our study says nothing about when that passing year, if it happens, will happen. That will depend on relative GDP growth rates, relative inflation levels, and exchange rate dynamics in the years ahead. But if, perchance, you thought that maybe 2025 was going to be the passing point when you played with the little Economist widget to see when that's going to happen, our results should make you walk that back about 3 years sooner than would otherwise happen, because China's about $1 trillion bigger than we thought it was on an apples-to-apples basis compared to the United States. And finally, after real estate, the proper treatment of research and development investment in China is really a very big result from our study here. It underscores just how important knowledge-intensive industries are for China's GDP size overall. And of course, when we go back to what we usually do, which is talk about growth in China, that is a singular area of importance for gauging how China will operate and perform both for its own sake and relative to us and other advanced economies in the years ahead. With that, thank you very much for the attention. I hope some of that is relevant to what you do for a living. Thanks.
Thank you, Dan and Bei. Why don't we invite our three commentators to come up on the stage? And as they're making their way up, I will introduce them, and then we will get started and let them pop. Sitting to my immediate right in just a couple seconds is Nick Lardy, who is the Anthony M. Solomon Senior Fellow at the Peterson Institute for International Economics. He previously was a senior fellow at the Brookings Institution, and prior to that, director of the Jackson School at the University of Washington. He's the author of numerous books on China, the most recent being Markets Over Mao, which was published last year. To his right is Markus Rodlauer, who's deputy director of the IMF's Asia and Pacific Department. Among other leadership responsibilities, he heads the fund's China team, which conducts the annual Article 4 consultations with the PRC in recent years. And you, if you look into the study, you'll see it plays a little bit of a story in the study in sort of sources for comparison of data. To our far right is Jiemin Guo, who's a senior economist at the Bureau of Economic Analysis in the Commerce Department. He's long been engaged in the production, research, and methodology development on national accounts and input-output accounts, as well as their applications from 2007 to 2012. Mr. Guo served as the head of the unit at the OECD Statistics Directorate, responsible for the OECD's quarterly accounting program, and led the OECD's national accounts cooperation projects with the National Bureau of Statistics of China. So we have three highly, highly qualified commentators to speak to today's report. We are not, though, going to raise the price of admission today at all. We know all of you are utility maximizers, and so we possibly couldn't possibly do that, but you're all in for a great treat. So I'll turn things first over to Nick, and then we'll go to Markus and Jiemin. Nick? Yeah, you could sit here. Yeah.
Thanks for the authors for completing this study, which I think is extremely useful. I think particularly its contributions fall into a number of areas. I think, first of all, it provides a very interesting institutional history, particularly, as Dan mentioned, the transition from the net material product system that China adopted from the Soviet Union in the 50s towards the system of national accounts, which is the kind of gold standard used by most countries. And the challenges in that transition are outlined very clearly. It took 7 or 8 years before they were completely off the traditional system. Then he takes us through, the study takes us through also the evolution of SNA from the 1993 to the 2008 version, which you heard a little bit about. And there are all kinds of interesting details, at least interesting to me, on the staffing of the National Income Accounting Office within the National Statistical Bureau and the relations of that office to other departments within the Bureau and the problems that that has sometimes created. And they didn't have time to touch on any of this. So if you're interested in those kinds of things, I think you'll certainly want to read the study. I think the second contribution is that the study really convincingly argues that China has made major improvements to improve the comparability of China's data with other countries by moving to SNA and adopting some of the revisions to SNA that have occurred over the years, and to improve the accuracy of the underlying data. And I think the bottom line of the study, although I don't quite hear either of the authors say that, there's not much evidence of outright fabrication of data. They've got lots of problems. It's a complex economy, lots of problems in accurately measuring what's going on. The third contribution is, at the beginning, they tell us that this is a study to, as Dan mentioned, to tell us what nominal GDP was in 2008. They actually go and provide us with a lot more information. Very detailed analysis of how the methodologies have evolved even since 2008, up-to-date analysis of up-to-date data, which they used to try to gauge what was really going on in 2008. So it's much more, I believe, than simply an estimate of what nominal GDP was in 2008. They also highlight important breaks in key data series, which will be of interest to a lot of people who are trying to do detailed work on this. So we learn a lot more about the evolution of GDP accounting from this study. We're not just learning about the size of GDP in 2008. Now, so those are some of the contributions, at least as I read the study. The findings, I think, were summarized very well at the beginning. GDP in 2008 was estimated to be at least 4.1 trillion to as much as 5.1 trillion more than the officially reported number, which means their estimate is 13% to 16% higher than the official number. However, if we abstract from the treatment of R&D expenditures as an investment as rather than an intermediate input, about three quarters of the difference between the NSB number and the author's estimate is attributable to the tertiary sector. In other words, the adjustments in agriculture and related primary activities is relatively small. As we saw, industry is a little bit bigger, but the really big changes come in the tertiary sector. About two-thirds of the adjustment in the tertiary sector is attributable to adjustments in real estate, which is one of 14 subsectors of the service portion of the Chinese economy. So the bottom line is, and this was mentioned along the way, the real estate adjustment accounts for about half the difference. Now, I'm quite frankly a little bit worried about the real estate estimates because it does loom so large in the recalculation. They use three different methodologies, independent methods, which respectively would add 1.9, 1.1, and 0.4 trillion to the official output figure for real estate, which is roughly 1.5 trillion. But unlike in other cases where the authors take an average of the estimates of several different methodologies, in this case, they opted for the highest estimate, the 1.9 trillion number, and as was pointed out, that means in their estimate, the size of the real estate sector is roughly twice what is reflected in the official data. But I'm a little bit worried about the approach to the 1.9 trillion additional real estate value added. This is the so-called market rent approach. It requires quite a number of assumptions, most of which look quite reasonable. But I'm not so sure that it seems to me that there has been a change in 2013 in which rental income from property was reclassified. It used to be part of property income. It was changed to be business income. I guess there are enough people renting out real estate that they consider it a business now. And they take the ratio of some numbers in 2013 and assume that the same ratio applies back in 2008. But the reclassification that occurred in 2013 I think may lead to a substantial overestimate of the average actual rent per square meter in urban areas and possibly to too large an upward adjustment in real estate value added. So I apologize for going into some of these details. They're a little bit arcane. But I guess if my understanding of the author's estimate is correct and my understanding of the NSB reclassification of rental income from property, from the property income category to the business income category is correct, then I think it calls into question what I think is probably the single most important conclusion of the study, that is that China's economy is less imbalanced than reflected in the official data because household consumption in the form of housing services is substantially underestimated by the NSB. By the way, I do believe it's underestimated. The second book ago, I actually had an appendix examining some of the details about the problems in measuring value add in the real estate sector, and I think it is understated. But whether it's understated by more than 100%, I think is, I'm a little bit uncertain. Now, so let me just go to a conclusion. I think this book will be an extraordinary reference for those who seek to understand the evolution of China's national income accounting. There is a great deal of attention and detail about discontinuity in data series, and the one question I would raise is, as a reader, the question I have is, do they lead to a large under or overstatement of China's long-term economic growth, or are these discontinuities just, you know, small, minor things which we could correct for them wouldn't make much difference? Well, perhaps wisely, the authors at the outset said we're not in the business of estimating what long-term economic growth in China is. We want to get a very, the best estimate possible for output in 2008. But I think if you're looking for kind of the long-term growth number, it's not going to be in the study. You have to read through a lot about discontinuities in the data without really understanding whether they change our view about what the long-term growth pattern has been. So, and finally, I would say, I think it, my view would be we still need to do a lot more work on the real estate sector to try to improve on the estimates, how much upward revision does there need to be. I think the study has highlighted the fact that the Chinese have stated that they're going to move to a new methodology, and there have been a number of studies published by people in the National Income Accounts section which are cited. So this is a problem they've been grappling with for quite some time. But for whatever reason, they haven't yet gotten to the point where they're comfortable revising the numbers. So I guess that would be another major conclusion, that we probably still need more work on the real estate sector. And hopefully the Chinese authorities will help us out by updating those numbers, and more importantly, explaining the methodology that they use for doing that. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you very much. Marcus?
Good morning, and thanks for the opportunity to comment on this very important and timely report. We all know that recently data issues have once again come to the forefront of the China debate. As the economy is slowing, many are questioning whether the speed of the slowdown is actually much sharper than the official statistics might suggest. Against this background, this book, Broken Abacus, is obviously a highly relevant piece of work, and we at the IMF strongly welcome it. It, as Nick has said, it gives a great overview of the history of and the current status of the national accounts, including an important overall assessment of the methodology, the transparency, and the political interest that might still shape the numbers in one form or another. And it also gives a detailed quantitative estimate of China's GDP data for 2008, some work that really many of those who come to quick conclusions about China's data do not do and should do, which is to go into the weeds, to look at the real numbers that are available and assess them in more detail. I will not go into the recap. I have a whole page here prepared to recap the findings. This has been done very well by Dan and by Nick. Let me just highlight four keywords. Progress, tremendous progress has been made in modernizing the statistics. China is bigger, not smaller than we thought. Real estate is more important, and structural adjustment has been well underway for a while. Two points that maybe haven't been highlighted so far is that, nonetheless, the study points out there are still important shortcomings, like for most, if not all, economies, including what the authors call archaic GDP production boundary and counting conventions. That's kind of struck me, which in some areas lead to underreporting of the levels of GDP, but by implication might also lead to underreporting or misreporting the second derivative, the change, when it happens. And also the authors do see the Chinese statistics and transparently as still sometimes shaped by political interests, as evidenced in their view by the recent December 2014 release revisions, where the opportunity for larger revisions was missed. Overall, however, I fully concur with the author's main findings that China is making continuous progress to align its statistical system with international standards and best practices, but also that further improvements are still required to improve the quality of those data. China's departures from the international standards and best practices are, however, several and quite tangible, but they are comparable with other transition countries that are moving to market-based economies. I also believe that continued efforts from the authorities are required for improving the national accounts in the three areas that are identified by the authors: transparency, accuracy of measurement, and incentives for correct data reporting and publication at all levels and throughout the country. As to the quantitative findings of the study, it should be noted that there is perhaps somewhat more uncertainty in the authors' estimates than has been presented. The calculation methods at times make use of unverifiable assumptions, and sometimes perhaps even outdated assumptions. And in some areas, they do lack the rigor of national accounts compilation practices that are used by statistical agencies. Given the nature of this exercise, which is a top-down, outside look into the books, this may be to some extent unavoidable, but still, we must be aware. Two examples are the calculation methods that Nick already used, one of them mentioned for re-estimating the inputted rents and the value added of non-directly reported industrial industries, small enterprises. These two components account for almost 75% of the increase in the 2008 estimates over the existing official data. On imputed rents, Nick already explained part of the issues. On our side, when we looked into this, I want to spare the details, but the bottom line is that the fact that the share of rented housing in China is still very, very small. And the 2008 SNA specifies that the market-based imputed rent approach should really only be used when a well-organized market for rental housing exists. It is not clear whether the market rent equivalent approach used here would provide really a more accurate estimate of the official than the official methodology, which does use a methodology, which is the user cost approach. Secondly, on the small enterprises, the non-directly reporting industrial entities, those are enterprises below a revenue threshold of 5 million renminbi of turnover, and self-employed businesses. Here, a key assumption in the book is that these small enterprises tend to have higher value added to output ratios than the larger ones, thanks to their shorter production chains. This assumption cannot be verified in the actual data due to the lack of value-added information on small enterprises. That's the small ones. For the self-employed businesses, the authors use a combination of indirect methods based on provincial data and labor statistics, as we have seen. This approach appears to be less reliable, however, than the official NBS methodology, which does rely on tax records of almost 29 million of licensed self-employed businesses, which is over half of the number. A final observation and a final question. The one observation is an obvious one, but still worth making, and perhaps we can follow this up in our discussion later on. The current debate and concern about China's data is perhaps not so much about the level of GDP, but whether China's economic statistics are massively overstating growth. Is China now, rather than growing by 6 to 7%, really growing by only 3 to 4% or less? Broken Abacus gives us some answer to this question by largely dispelling the notion that Chinese GDP data, as Nick has said, are either a fabrication emerging from an unreliable and political bureaucracy, or, which is also dispelled, are they technically so flawed that one has to a priori discount them heavily? On a technical level, what most analysts focus on in this context has to do with the correlation between GDP, official numbers, and the higher frequency indicators, and with the deflator, converting nominal to real GDP growth. Broken Abacus, again, provides us a useful initial answer to this question. Historical correlations and their evolution over time with structural change do suggest that GDP data do reflect real growth quite accurately, though probably with some margin of uncertainty again. A question here is, has this margin of uncertainty increased, or could it increase? Is there a sudden shift of sentiment? Again, most other studies that go a bit into the weeds, that look at this in some more detail than just superficially, come to a similar conclusion that the primary bias in China's statistics is not to overstate average growth, but to understate the volatility of growth. But that on average, the gap between the headline GDP and these alternate approaches is not that large, less than a percentage point most of the time. So we are somewhere in a range of growth of 6 to 7, or maybe between 1 or 2%, plus minus 1%. A final question, what does all this mean for the demand side? If output is much higher than we thought, where is the demand coming from? Is it consumption? Is it investment? Nick has alluded to it, that much of it may well be consumption, and therefore we might also be along further in the rebalancing towards consumption, but it may be a worthwhile question to ask. Let me close by reiterating what I said at the beginning. We highly welcome this report. It's a great contribution to the debate about Chinese data, and it's highly valuable, most of all, I think, for Chinese data users, which are the authorities themselves, who are the most important consumers of statistical data in China for policymaking. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here and give a comment on this very important and interesting report on Chinese national accounts. Before I get to my point, I want to say something that when I first was invited to give a comment on this, I was reluctant, because I know for a long time, for working on national accounts, this is not easy work, it's dirty work, and it's very, very technical. and it's not easy task. And somebody from nowhere came to send me the report. Okay, you should look at this revaluation of Chinese GDP. National accounts are very narrow area. We have some international experts, which I personally know most of them, and they work very closely with the definitions, with these evolutions, revisions of this system. And in practice, it's quite difficult to go into a country's system and give a good pointed valuation. And IMF has been doing that, and OECD has been doing that, but with a lot of experts involved. But this is independent study. When I first look at it, I was hesitating. But in the end, when I read that, I was very impressed with the work. And I can't believe they could put such a technical work into. This is very interesting reading, and go so deep into Chinese national account system and make pinpoint where the potential problems are, and also appraise the evolution of Chinese system, and which in large count, I will repeat later, that is consistent to what my personal experience with Chinese national accounts. But anyway, it's a pleasure to be here. And in preparing for these comments, last week, there was a report by Reuters about I just found online that says China changes GDP data calculation method to improve accuracy. I'm not sure how many people have noticed that. And then when I look at that, okay, I know where this came from. In China, just last week, they announced they will change the accounting system for quarterly national accounts. And that feedback, when I worked at the OECD in 2009, just after the economic financial crisis, China has a tremendous pressure to have this more updated measurement to deal with this crisis. And then they reach out to OECD to help with their quarterly national accounts, basically quarterly GDP. And the core problem for the China's quarterly GDP was it was not quarter by quarter, it was an accumulated approach. It's not emphasized in this report, but I want to repeat. Then we were sending experts, and we have trainings, and we hope China's quarterly national accounts should be in line with the international standard, which took a long time. I'm glad to know finally they make this announcement last week. They changed that, and that is important piece of the work. And that will be my first point of this this report. And the report, it says China systematically, the evolution of Chinese official GDP and national accounts in general inconsistent with the international standard, which I agree. I think it's make a very good point. What it should be mentioned is that when China opened up and then the national accounts from NPS to SNA in early 90s, and they need to have this technical assistance. And as early as 1996, and they reach out to the OECD, and then there was a formal OECD MBS workshop on national accounts annual. Throughout these years, these national accounts produced hundreds of papers and the research in tackled different areas where it started with the Chinese side. They raised the questions, asked the assistant in the helping in modernizing their system. And a lot of topics which have been addressed in this report have been addressed and then either being improved or being consistent with the international standard. And so with that, those modernization of Chinese national account system is a combination of the efforts from within China and outside China. And from, with the OECD's help with the IMF, and also they have this exchange program with United Nations Statistical Division, and constantly exchange the stuff to increase their skills or capacities in their national accounts. So this point, I think that it's well written. I think it's more revealing to people who have questions about Chinese system, and when they are challenged about the accuracy of Chinese data, more likely the overestimating and or the political size of GDP. There are a lot of questions even within China. And so, but by and large, the system is quite consistent with the Chinese, with the international standard. That's my first point. It's right, well good, well written. The second, it's difficult to make the comments as the last because this very well organizers with the comments already make all the points. So China is bigger, not smaller. So it's been repeating, and it's the main, it's the main point of this report. Do we have questions about that? I think it's a shocking to many people, because people challenged the quality of Chinese numbers, challenged about the accuracy of this GDP, more likely to challenge the overestimate than what the report shows, underestimate. And that is not easy question to answer. But to me, I think that's make very good points. It reflects me that when I have the years of exchange with various levels of Chinese national accountants or statisticians at the central and the regional level, I've seen people saying both sides. One example, I was in 2009, I was in a province talking with a discussion with a local statistical official. He said the MBS, the Central Statistics Bureau, asked us to reduce our speed, the growth rate, or that. It's a very difficult thing to do for them because there are a lot of activities that when they collect it, they add up to that. And there is no incentive for them to hide that, either hide that or to try to exaggerate, because that was the MBS impression to some of the region's GDP numbers, because the average regional GDP growth rate were much larger than national, 4 or 5 percentage higher. But for that, because of these various activities was not formally collected by the formal statistical system, there could be well underestimating by those formal channels. So that is an example. So I agree with both of the two speakers about the detailed calculation of some of those results, and especially the size of the real estate, that's the more than one trillion increase. In fact, that when I was at the OECD, that is one of the topics. We have several rounds of discussion with the MBS professionals, and then they used a cost approach, as indicated in this report. And there's, as Mark just mentioned, there's no market reference rent, because there is no material market for measuring the rental. That's imputed as part of the GDP, not like in the US and other advanced countries. So they use the cost approach, which could well underestimate the actual value of that part of the economy. So I think in between, there's something underestimation that's true, but we need more robust method, I agree. that is maybe something that was exploring after this report. And my last point is the report says it's not contradiction to say that China is aligned with international GDP of practice. Well, at the same time, current measures are insufficient. And this is quite an accurate statement. In fact, that can apply to other countries. And even with the US national accounts, we are not totally in line with S&A. We have some, we are in advance to capitalize software in 1993 S&A. We capitalize R&Ds that lead to the 2000 S&A. That's all lead the world in that kind of practice. But we haven't count on something like the valuables, that's underground economy, illegal economy, that was supposed to be part of the GDP, which some other European countries already did. So in short, that the challenges remains on what data you have, your current system, can you capture all those activities? Not that we don't want to to have that, it's just we don't have sufficient data. And that, for China, they are facing more challenges because when they are adopting this international standard and dealing with a rapidly changing economy, it's not easy work. I remember when the first economic census, 2004 census, I and my colleague were invited to Beijing to give some advice on how to backcast of those years. So the in the report you mentioned it was like a nearly 17% GDP increase than previously estimated for 2003, and how to put that back into the history. And what you mentioned, that first year of first time of census, that's exactly the 100 years of US census. We have years of census. You don't have a point to go back. So backcasting is not simple work, it's not easy. So they are facing a lot more challenges than other advanced economy. So part of that can answer the report's challenges to why China was not willingly to dealing with that. I think a lot of them lies on the capability and also the shortage of resources. As you mentioned in your report, that the NBS has only 30 plus employees dealing with the national accounts, and the BEA, we are not counterpart of MBS, but we are counterpart of the national accounts. We have 500 people doing these national accounts. They are well understaffed, and that is part of this is the issue. And another advice, if I can take, so to improve the quality of Chinese national accounts, will be combine the economic census with the input-output survey. The input-output survey is a separate survey every 5 years. So it's the same as the economic census, but that is a separate budget that does not really go together with the national accounts accounting. On the other hand, the economic census, when they design the questionnaire, don't ask a lot of national accounts questions. Where in the US, the economic census, BEA is the main partner when they roll out the next census. BEA gave a lot of inputs based on what's the needs of the economy, the new economy. So another advice would be China needs to change some of the practices in their collecting data. And the last one I would like to make is that the international organizations or experts needs to be more engaged. I know the IMF has been doing the evaluation, examining Chinese systems. OECD has been doing a lot of its share of putting technical assistance, but that's not sufficient. I think China is willing to improve. We get a lot of envy from other emerging countries. When we have this workshop, we invited Indian, and Indian said, why not for India? We spend a lot for international resources on improving Chinese GDP measurement, but China becomes so big and India becomes so big, so we need more of international cooperation towards that and need to put more resources in that direction. In short, Chinese economy is so big. It's bigger than what we thought, maybe. And we have to have a good measure. And that needs a lot of people's efforts together. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jiemin. Thanks to all three commentators for carefully reading, analyzing, and commenting on the report. We want to go to the audience very soon, but I want to give Dan and Bay a chance to make an initial reaction to your comments. We don't have time for you to go through each of the points that they made, but if you have just an initial reaction, and then we'll go to the audience and get questions and comments from them.
Thanks, Scott. Well, first of all, just our gratitude to Nick, Markus, and Jiemin for those comments, critical assessment. If only the China skeptics on the other side of this whole debate, who think the whole thing is a Potemkin village, give us just that level of critique of this study, then we'll be in great shape. So all the things you mentioned are things we considered and thought about a lot, Bay and I, in the course of the study. And let me give her a minute, to touch on some of the reasons for the choices we made.
Thank you so much for the very valuable questions. When we finished this study, Dan joked to me saying that all people were going to jump to the concluding section where only 15 people will look at chapter 3, which is two-thirds of the book on methodology. And currently, I have like 3 highly, highly valued panelists reading this section, so mission 20% accomplished. Nick's question is very important on the choices we made regarding the rental income, but there's an important thing to point out that compared with the subsectors in which we took average of different project results, it's very different from our approach towards real estate, because for the other services subsectors, we follow the official methods. We're just using different approaches to stress test the official method and data, and that's why we got an average of the results. Whereas for the real estate, we revamp the official method. We do not think the user cost approach that officials use can best reflect the share of the real estate. In fact, NBS themselves have undertaken the real estate rental surveys, starting from Shenzhen to other pilot cities in the provinces, trying to reflect a better size of the real estate economy, knowing that real estate today has been underrepresented in both GDP and the CPI. So we do not think that's a capacity issue, or user cost is still the best approach in China today to describe that. In terms of the 3 choices we make, we just very, very briefly to mention like the choices we make, not trying to go too technical on that. So the first approach, as Nick said, we had used the market rent approach with the standard preferred way proposed not just in ISA 2008, but also in ISA 1993. That's for countries with developed rental market to use to count their rental services and the real estate services. But Beijing back then claimed that, they do not have the adequate data, so they have to use a user account because China's the home ownership is like 80-85% really high compared with, in advanced economies. But currently, because they have done their exercise themselves, so we think using the market value instead of the user cost is a better way to describe the picture. The rest of 2 approaches are based on the housing value, the purchase value, and also the construction cost. Just to give you one example, like if Scott and I live in 2 comparable units in 1 apartment, whereas Scott is a tenant and I'm a homeowner, if I rent this to someone, to Scott, I would charge a little bit more premium than the value, that the price I pay for the apartment. And of course, that's also higher than the construction cost of the apartment. So the 3 prices, 3 values we chose for this approach is the construction cost and the values I purchased this house, and also the market rate I would rent to a tenant like Scott. So we think the first approach based on the market value is the best and preferred, suggested in the SN 2008, and that's what we used in this. And from SNA and other academics, and they have undertaken multiple efforts over the last 3-4 years doing the calculations from different ways using market rate to describe the real estate sector given its importance and policy relevance. And then the approach we use here is like what they used in their study, including by the deputy director of the MBS, Xu Xianchun, who is like the founding father of the modern GDP accounting standard in China today. So that's our response.
I mean, that said, to be clear, Nick's absolutely right, and Markus as well. Mm-hmm. That is such an outsized part of our result that considerable attention needs to be paid to those kinds of choices we had to grapple with in deciding which way we wanted to go. So it's absolutely the right question, and there's a viable case to be made in either direction. Happily, regardless of which choice we made there, the overall direction of the result, that China's actually bigger and significantly so, not smaller than thought, is, if we can just make that step in terms of general consensus, I think we'll have done something useful.
Okay, thanks both of you. Given the constraints on time, I think the best thing we ought to do right now is just have allow several questions or comments all together rather than one by one. So if you'd please raise your hand, identify who you are, your organization, and then if you could keep your question to a single question, relatively short, I'd really appreciate it. We'll start right here. Please wait for the mics because of our friends on the web.
Steve Winders, a consultant. Could you address a question that sort of came up of the relevance of provincial data versus overall data, particularly given the size of China? So, for example, in the real estate issue and what the significance for the economy, it might be a crucial issue in a certain province, not so much another province. So,
okay, provincial. We'll come here. We'd need a mic to the front here. All right.
Chris McCray, Value True. My question would be on education. My father's work at The Economist suggested that education was the most vital of all sectors for the net generation, but there, in your statistics, it seems to account in value added for just under 3% and actually be even less by your analysis. So could you give some context to that, please?
Okay. I come over here to this gentleman.
Hi, my name is Dong Huiyu with China Review News Agency of Hong Kong. And I'm wondering if these fundings are accepted by the administration, what would be the implication for the upcoming summit to talk about the economic relations between the two countries? Thank you.
Okay, let's have one more, this gentleman right here. Yes.
I think many of us remember, I'm Robert Griffiths, now at the National Defense University, former Consul General in Shanghai. We all remember Zhu Rongji's press conference many years ago when he famously pointed out that the reported GDP growth from all the provinces except two were higher than the national average, and implying that the data was being cooked a little bit for political reasons. And indeed, Communist Party officials were getting promoted on the basis of their GDP growth as one of their primary methods for getting promoted. So could you speak just a little bit as to how confident you are that there isn't a bias because of those factors in the data that you are working with?
Terrific. Thanks for the questions. I'm just going to add one small question as well and prioritize answering their questions over answering mine, but I just wanted to raise it since I think it's a little bit relevant. I don't know if anyone remembers a book called 1587, A Year of No Significance. 2008 is a year of significance in China because the growth trajectory during that year was not consistent over the year. First half of the year, growth pretty fast, and then the global financial crisis breaks out, and by Q4, growth in China slows down quite a bit. Now, there's a lot of technical reasons why you went with 2008 as your base year. Totally makes sense. Are there any challenges or concerns that one ought to have for using a year in which the growth pattern was so strong and then weakened considerably by the end of the year that they had to come out with announce a $4 trillion stimulus package? Or, I'm asking as a non-expert on national accounting, or does that type of variation within the year basically not matter because the way they collect the data essentially consistent across the year. I'm just thinking that as you got a lot of slower growth, maybe it slowed more in manufacturing than in services, but they didn't capture that, and so maybe that would have meant sort of a redistribution of the way the type of data would have displayed itself in that one critical year. Again, you can't control for that. You're dealing with a very difficult situation. That's a great year. That's the year you need to go with. A lot of transparency issues. But anyway, I just raise it as just a question. All right. So.
Let me touch on two high-level points and then ask Bay to mop up some of the more technical questions. Touch on the last question to do with 2008, and then touch on the question about the summit, whether this has much relevance for it. In a way, Scott, the opportunity for us to use 2008 as our base year was fortuitous, because in fact, 2008 was in many ways more characteristic of the years to follow through today than the years pre-2008 were, right? It's sort of the beginning of the new era, post-hyper-Chinese supercycle growth that characterized the economy until the late 2000s. So really we, on the one hand, we're concerned about 2008 being a particularly volatile time, but in many ways we look at the dynamics playing through the Chinese economy in that year, and they better describe the intervening years in many ways than using 2007, 6, 5 or something, or even having a later year to rely on to some extent, depending on which one we picked. In terms of the summit, just one thought here. NBS, you guys, Jiemin, have 500 people working on national accounts. NBS has 30 career dedicated people working on this. One young Chinese genius and one middle-aged American guy who hadn't written a book on China national accounts before spent 2 years of effort trying to earnestly come up with a study that could bring people together around a more shared, less alarmist understanding of what's going on in Chinese GDP. I hope that if they have a moment, our leaders, in the context of a summit or otherwise, might find time to appreciate that behind them, in line, in each of our two nations, we have people working together to find agreeable, as objective as possible ways to describe the nature of our economies separately and how they interact. And that by doing that and producing better data that's made accessible to general readers as well, we can actually build more of a consensus about how we can work together in the future. And also the final note on that, the era in which things can be done in obscurity in China is largely over. My favorite quote in the study is actually taken from the Guangzi, which is an ancient collection of Chinese essays on statecraft, one of the lines of which is, we must do national census to understand our power, but we must keep them secret, because if the statistical numbers are known from the people, then the people will control government. And in fact, to some extent, that is true, that putting so much data in the public domain for use is, in fact, part of the bargain we have in a modern society, that the people have a right, both in terms of their own leadership and then looking across their borders at how their neighbors interact with them, to better understand the performance of their governments and their nations. With that high-minded doggerel, let me ask Bei to actually fill in concretely how we dealt with a couple of those technical issues.
Yeah, the two questions there regarding the provincial data are very critical, because the sum of the China's provincial GDP and the national aggregate, increased over the years from 3 to 5 to 8% was a serious issue. That concerns the bureaucratic structure of China's data system. So in China, there are two parallel systems in the data collections. One is the Central National Bureau of Statistics, who does national data on the country's level, and also the provincial government who do provincial data for their own provinces. So these two parallel data do not borrow from each other in terms of coming up with the final numbers. And the final numbers we see from the Beijing always come from this vertical system, that's centrally controlled. And this tiered system is not idiosyncratic in China. Like in Japan, they have this tiered system as well. And the sum of the regional GDP in Japan and their national aggregate also has about 5%. 5% on average a divide over the last decade. For this study, we used only in one instance for the smaller industrial enterprises, we used the provincial data, but then used value-added data to adjust the value-added data there, just as a way to stress testing. But for all other steps, we all use the central systems data, which we consider of better quality. And in terms of the rental data, if the real estate market varies across the provinces, there's actually a good survey we set from, which was, I give credit to the Southwest University of Finance Economics. They have been running a very comprehensive nationwide China's household survey for many years, and they have data on the rental income, property income nationwide. And because the rental income data we got from other places, from the NBS, are also on a national scale, so the data there are comparable. So we do not have a by province calculation there and add them up. So that's not a technical issue for this one.
Hey, this has been an extremely illuminating conversation and based on an extremely illuminating report. There's a Chinese saying in the conversation that you want a pao zhuan yin yu, which is you want to throw out a brick in order to get some jade. Well, I think actually they threw out some jade and we got some more jade with some terrific commentary as well and from all the audience. And it leaves me less jaded about China's economy than otherwise. So please join me in thanking Dan and Bei and our commentators for a great job.